Good morning, Anna Maria.
We just learned last night on CBC News that there were secret discussions to broker a compromise with Jody Wilson-Raybould before you were both removed from caucus this week. Were you part of those discussions?
Well, there were allegations around some discussions that took place. I'm not sure what the source of that information was or how the CBC or others would have found out about those conversations. You know, I can't speak to any conversations that Jody Wilson-Raybould was involved in. For my part, I would say there were very, very few conversations that took place between myself and the Prime Minister's office over the last number of weeks. In fact, there was probably only one conversation.
And when was that conversation?
That was a few days ago, probably about a week ago.
And were you looking for anything from the Prime Minister at that point? Were you looking for an apology?
Well, I have been very clear from the beginning of when this took place. The issue, just to remind your listeners, is that there is very good evidence that there were attempts to interfere with, have political interference with a very serious criminal trial. And I had to resign from cabinet because I was not willing to deny that that took place. And from the beginning, I have tried to suggest that the way to deal with this is to speak the truth, to admit that mistakes were made, to apologize to Canadians for it, and find out how it happened and make sure it never happens again. That's been my stance from the beginning that I've communicated to the Prime Minister and his office and others. So to that extent, there have been conversations going on, but I would not say that they were intense in any way. There were no efforts to bring all the people involved into a room together to actually try to resolve this. So I would have to say, fairly stunned when I was expelled from caucus on Tuesday without ever having had an opportunity to speak to caucus to share my perspective on what had happened and why I had resigned from cabinet, for example.
And how did you find out you were expelled from caucus?
The Prime Minister invited me to his office and told me.
And what was that conversation like?
It was a relatively brief conversation. He gave some reasons why he felt he had to make that decision. Obviously, it's the Prime Minister's, he's the leader of the party and the Prime Minister of our country, and I respect his decisions and his authority. I wished him well, and, you know, I hope that this will not have negative outcomes for those who are trying to move forward on really important causes for our country. I believe that I have positive things to contribute as a member of Parliament from Markham Stouffville, and I can do that as an independent, but I thought that I could perhaps do even more by working alongside my former Liberal colleagues. But I respect the decision that was made, and I said to the Prime Minister that I do wish him the best.
So, but you talked to him a week before. What was the tone of the?
No, I did not talk to him the week before. I had not had a conversation with him from the time I resigned from cabinet until the day that he expelled me.
Okay, and what was the tone of this conversation when he told you you were out? Then, but what was his tone?
I think everyone wishes that we were not in these circumstances. Obviously, if the clocks could be rolled back many months, that this attempted interference had never taken place, then we wouldn't be in this regrettable situation that we're in. So I think there's a tone of sadness and regret because it has taken away the attention of ministers and others to focus on some of the important issues. So obviously it would be great if none of this had ever happened. I always think that one of the things I learned in medicine was that, you know, when bad things happen, when mistakes are made, errors take place, the sooner you deal with it, the sooner you admit that, you know, without malice, sometimes errors take place. But you need to own up to that. You need to apologize to the people that may have been harmed. And you need to find out why it happened and make sure it never happens again. I think those lessons could be transferred quite easily into the political sphere, and this could have been taken care of and addressed in a forthright, honest way much earlier.
And so just to be clear, though, you weren't in any kind of discussion to get back into the fold in terms of like a discussion. We know that there was a discussion with Ms. Wilson-Raybould with certain conditions.
Well, I don't know where you got that information from. Certainly, I can speak for myself. I would never reveal the content of or the even the details of conversations I had when I was a cabinet minister with the prime minister. Those are confidential conversations. So I think it would be good to talk to Ms. Wilson-Raybould to confirm her perspective on the stories that were, I gather, leaked to the CBC from some sources. So I don't really want to comment on that in particular. I would say that there were people that were very well-meaning people, members of my caucus colleague, former caucus colleagues, who reached out to me to try to have positive conversations and see what could be done. I was always happy to have those conversations, and I appreciated those who came to me in a respectful way to ask about what could happen. But from my perspective, there was no formal process or effort to try to resolve the impasse.
Why do you think more members of the Liberal Cabinet and Caucus have not rallied around you and Ms. Wilson-Raybould?
Well, what I did, for example, I have to say was a hard thing to do. I made the decision to resign from cabinet because there is a constitutional convention of cabinet solidarity that means that when we talk about a decision in cabinet, we may air our disagreements around the table privately, but we have to go out from that room of one mind, prepared to defend and support the decision that we have made together. And I've always been able to do that on any of the other important issues that we've talked about. In this case, this is the issue at the heart of this is the independence of our justice system. We cannot have a democracy without a independent justice system that is free from political interference. And I felt there was evidence that there had been some attempts of interference. And the expectations of cabinet ministers to deny that the interference took place and or to suggest that it didn't matter, that it wasn't important in some way, was not something that I could do in good conscience. And so I could not meet my expectation of cabinet solidarity on that matter. But it was a very hard thing. I don't want to go into a lot of detail, but I have received some treatment, which I think is less than respectful, from former colleagues and lots of folks on social media and elsewhere. And that, you know, that's not what this story is about. I can deal with critique, but it takes a certain measure of courage to step up and do something that is going to upset others. But I believe so strongly in the importance of us as a country having a justice system that we can trust, to know that decisions are not going to be made in the courts based on whether the person or the company on trial is friends with or associated with a particular politician who will plead their case. That's the fundamental issue here.
So do we have a justice system in Canada that is that is now deeply flawed? You left. You didn't get what you wanted. it didn't change. Does that mean our justice system is flawed as it stands right now under this Liberal government?
No, in fact, I think Canadians can be very thankful that that the system did work. I believe it worked because the former Attorney General did not bend to the wishes of those who wanted her to interfere in the trial. The decision around this particular trial, the SNC-Lavalin case, it's been described in by some as the largest corporate corruption trial in modern Canadian history. It's not an insignificant trial in any way. And there is a person called the Director of Public Prosecutions who is completely non-political, who has a large office of people who are trained in criminal prosecutions. She made the determination that this should go to trial. There is a tool that the former Attorney General could have used if this company qualified, but the Director of Public Prosecution said they did not qualify for that and gave lots of evidence as to why. We can be thankful that we did not have political interference didn't occur, but it was because the former Attorney General was not willing to meddle.
And you make the point that she did not bend. So, Jane Philpott, if she didn't bend, why do you have to resign? Did you not deal with it internally, even with a big... help me understand.
Sure,
In fact, it didn't happen, right?
It didn't happen, which is great.
It didn't happen. So why would you step away?
The problem was that the decision of the government at large was to go out. And the first lines that you may have heard when the story broke initially in the Globe and Mail, the first lines that very day were this, the allegations are entirely false. Well, we know now that they weren't entirely false. So I, of course, would not have felt comfortable having believed the former Attorney General. I did not feel comfortable going out and saying the allegations are false. The story of the government has changed now to not necessarily denying the allegations, but to saying, well, it doesn't actually matter, is, I think, the general tone of the messaging at the moment. And I don't believe that either, because I believe it does matter that this attempted interference took place. And it does matter. And I think Canadians deserve to know that someone takes responsibility and apologizes for what took place. I essentially couldn't go out and, to use a much used phrase, toe the party line on this. And as a cabinet minister, I had the obligation to do that. Not members of parliament don't have to agree entirely with the government. That's in fact how the system's supposed to work, that members of parliament are free to hold the government to account, even if they are caucus members of the same party. But a cabinet minister has to be able to defend entirely and say in good conscience that they support the approach of the government. I couldn't do that because I felt that our approach was wrong.
And does that suggest that you think that the government will, now that Jody Wilson-Raybould is not the Attorney General, that with a new Attorney General, the government will do exactly what it wanted to do under her?
I have no information as to what the plan is. As I said, a long time ago, the Director of Public Prosecutions said that they do not qualify. I assume that the current Attorney General will not allow himself to be the victim of interference in causing him to step in unless he has some new information. But I'm not privy to those details.
Okay. I just want to ask you, have been a star cabinet minister with big portfolios, a reputation when you got Treasury Board for being the one who gets things done. With all the priorities you championed as a senior member of the Liberal Cabinet, reconciliation, climate change, health, gender equality, you chose to sacrifice your political career over this.
Well, I chose the truth. I chose to act on principles that are so important to the future of our country. That's more important than my political career. I got into politics to improve people's lives, to be the very best member of parliament for Markham Stouffville that I could possibly be, to stand up for truth, to represent what I heard from my constituents. And if that means that in some way I've been taken out of opportunities that I had before. It makes me very sad. I loved the work that I was able to do, but I have to, you know, be able to speak to my children and my mother and my husband and say I did the right thing, and to my constituents and say I did the right thing. I spoke up and I spoke up for truth. And, you know, if that means that I can't continue in federal politics, that will make me very sad. I don't know what my political future holds at this point. I think there may be some opportunities out there for me yet. But the truth is more important than any individual's political success.
So if your decisions throughout this are about principles and doing the right thing, what does that say about the principles and the compass of your former colleagues in the Liberal Caucus? What does that say about the principles of the government you are no longer part of?
I don't think it would be fair for me to judge the principles of others. People have to make decisions for themselves.
But they didn't do what you did. So that suggests that you're suggesting that they don't have your principles.
No, well, I thank you for asking me to clarify that, because I don't want to suggest, obviously everybody in, honorable members of parliament from all parties are just that. They're honorable people who have the right to be here because their constituents sent them. They are all people of integrity. People, I suppose, have different bars, different principles that to them are lines that they can't cross. For me, this was something that I could not defend, the approach that was being taken on the SNC-Lavalin case, because I didn't support it. And I'm confronted by media every single day, putting a microphone in my face. I will never lie to the media or to the Canadian public and say something that I don't believe to be true. And for me to go out and say everything's fine, I didn't feel that was truth. From my perspective, I understand people have different perspectives. And so it just became untenable for me to be able to continue and be able to speak freely and fairly what I believe.
There's been a lot of criticism of Jody Wilson-Raybould for secretly recording her conversation with the then clerk of the Privy Council, Michael Wernick. Do you think what she did was ethically acceptable?
Well, I encourage people to read her submission that she sent to the Justice Committee, a very good 43-page document, and it explains the reasons why she made that tape. But what I would say is I think it's a bit of a red herring to be talking about whether or not her justification is reasonable, and not to focus on the content of the tape. What was said in that tape, what was being attempted in that tape, was to interfere with the Attorney General, who is, in that case, she was not wearing a political hat. She was representing the independent justice system. And there were attempts to try to make her do something that she didn't believe was the right thing to do. That's a disturbing tape. Especially falling on months of similar kinds of conversations. So I get that people find that it's unusual. Tapes or conversations in Ottawa between media and politicians and lawyers and et cetera are taped all the time
This is a minister of the Crown talking to the chief of the Privy Council and then releasing it. Is it a little different?
She will have explained that very well in her case, that she reached a point where she did not feel safe, where she had endured months of repeated efforts to get her to change her mind.
Jane Philpott, we're almost out of time here. Before I let
you
go,
I hope Canadians will want to know the truth. I think that's what they are saying to me.
We have to leave it there. Jane Philpott, thank you.
Thank you.